Hi, and welcome to my talk about spatial hashing and real-time rendering. The simulation of light transport is a computationally very expensive process in which we have to determine visibility and light bouncing and materials to generate images like this one. Over the years, there's been many techniques proposed to try to reduce the load on computations for this. And most techniques rely on some form of interpolation, extrapolation of the lighting, sharing information among pixels to try to obtain a smooth result in a minimum time. One of the tools that have been defined in this context is spatial hashing, in which the world can be separated in a number of hash cells for which we can compute information, store it in world space, and then reuse it to produce high quality images. If we have a closer look, then each element in the scene belongs to one hash cell. And this hash cell is actually a volume. And depending on the position of the volume, we can compute a hash key that will give us an index in memory where we can store, for example, irradiance. Then if we have another cell, the hash function will hash it somewhere else in memory and give us also a spot. If we have a closer look at what happens inside a hash cell, this cell usually covers several pixels, and for each pixel, we're going to trace a number of rays. Then the contributions of all those rays can be averaged together in that cell to provide a smooth estimate. And this is a kind of image we can obtain in real time using spatial hashing. Now, this technique really works well, but as we can see here, it works with diffuse surfaces because we store irradiance in there. So, well, the first opportunity we would have is to extend this approach to introduce level of view dependence so that we can render glossy surfaces as well. The spatial hashing is spreading information very nicely in memory space, but this means that neighboring cells in world space may be at completely different places in memory space, which makes it quite difficult to access coherently. The shape of the cells can also pose some problems, especially if some surfaces are exactly aligned with the boundaries of the cells, which can create some aliasing effects. And finally, if we could improve sampling, it would be great, because better sampling means better convergence, which means better real-time rendering. So let's start with the glossy surfaces. As we can see here, with various levels of glossiness, then that really changes the appearance of the surfaces depending on where we look at them from. If a point can have a completely different appearance depending on the viewpoint, then it means we cannot just accumulate irradiance values and reuse them over time. But we can do some form of temporal accumulation using exponential filtering. In this case, we would keep for each frame a proportion of what was computed in the previous frame and add a proportion of what was computed in a new frame. The big difference with screen space techniques that use similar exponential averaging is that we do this in world space, so we don't need any kind of reprojection in there. Everything is inherently in the world space and we can directly match the information from time t to time t plus 1. One problem is that this smoothing factor alpha is really determinant in the quality of the final image. If alpha is really small, then we will keep very little history, but that can generate some noise in the final image. On the contrary, if the alpha is really large, then we will keep information for a very long time, which can create some ghosting artifacts. So what we do is that we adapt it to the roughness of the surface. On a mirror-like surface, then we use a very low alpha because we want to throw away our history as fast as possible to be sure that our highlights are moving properly. On the other hand, if the surface is really rough, first, it will need a lot of rays to converge because of the spread of the BSDF. But the highlights will also move pretty slowly depending on the viewpoint. So that's a good candidate for a larger alpha. So we map this to an exponential curve that really matches well the perception we can have. And this is the kind of result we can obtain. So we can see that we have glossy reflections with a decent amount of detail, but we also have some artifacts due to the discretization of the hash map. For this, we resort to a screen space spatial filtering that will allow us to remove those edges. So the screen space filtering is based on several components. If we have a closer look here, when we consider the neighbors of a pixel, we first apply some Boolean criteria to decide whether a neighbor can be used to filter or not. And the first criterion we will use is the normal similarity. So instead of just weighting by dot product of the normals, for example, here we really apply a hard cut so that if the normals are a bit too different, then 2 points will absolutely not contribute to each other. And that's what allows us to keep those pixel perfect edges here. We also use a hard criterion on the world space distance because we really want to make sure that we don't spread information too far to avoid overblurring. If we use only those Boolean criteria, then we'll also generate some artifacts at the boundaries of the filters. So we also use some scalar weighting for the neighbors, and the two weightings we're using are inspired from the SVGF paper. One is based on the distance in screen space, and the other one, much more interesting, is based on the variance. So depending on the variance estimate at a point, then we may have a bigger or smaller filter. For example, if we have high variance, it means that we anticipate having a lot of noise. So we trade the spatial accuracy for noise reduction. Then in an area with lower noise, we will have a smaller kernel so that we can preserve details. And from the image we had in direct output of the hash map, this is the kind of image we can get, where we still preserve all the details, but all our boundaries are gone. And there's also a level of denoising. The next issue is memory coherence. As said before, if we have two neighboring cells in world space, they may absolutely not be neighbors in memory space, which means that we'll have to load different cache lines for those, and that results in a lot of memory inefficiencies. What we would like to have is more something like this, where we could hash neighboring cells into neighboring places also in memory. So let's represent our spatial hash map like this with our two cells of interest. And what we would like is to have them nearby as they are in world space. The first idea is to cluster them together. So we could have, for example, 2x2x2 voxels, and we can align our hashing function so that we store every cell in its own cluster. This works, of course, to put the neighboring cells together, but that has also the problem that most clusters will never be full. So we are wasting a lot of memory. What we propose is a loose clustering, if you will. That is, we have this notion of clusters, as we can have here, where neighbors can be stored together, but the beginning of the clusters are not aligned. This means that another cluster can start inside the first one and also put its information in there. Since we are not aligning, this has the advantage that we can use the complete memory we have available, so we don't waste the memory as before. Of course, we also have the problem that two clusters may overlap, so they may require the same hash entry. Fortunately, the hash map already has a collision mitigation technique, so in this case, we can simply rehash one of the candidates somewhere else. This means that in the best case, we achieve locality. In the worst case, we go back to the default behavior of spatial hash maps, so there's no loss possible. And it's even more than that, because by combining those two ideas of spreading and clustering, then we achieve a speed up of nearly 40% during the allocation of the cells per pixel. And since we speed up also all the memory accesses afterwards, our whole frame is sped up by around 20%. So now we can store our glossy information and we can store it efficiently to be able to be fetched in memory. One last issue we have with the spatial hash map itself is aliasing. If we have some cells that are exactly aligned with the geometric feature of the scene, then we have those artifacts that are akin to the fighting. And they are due to floating point approximations that will, in some case, use the higher cells and in some case use the lower ones. Some techniques have been proposed in the past to fix this problem, for example, using jittering. So we would first jitter a little bit the function so that we would take per pixel either the lower or higher one. This works, but this also introduces some per pixel noise, which is not what we want because we will need to denoise it afterwards. Another possibility is to allow a form of overlap of the cells, but then it means we double the memory bandwidth if ever we hit this overlap. Instead, we just have a look at our voxels, and the voxels are only defined by the hashing function. So if we change this hashing function, the voxels can have any shape we want. So for that, we decide to use sine waves to alter the position before computing the hashing. One obvious advantage we can see is that it's pretty unlikely that a scene element will follow exactly one of those curves. Another one is that we're using different wavelength for our sine waves, and this means that the corners of the cells are non-coplanar anymore. So even the corners may not match exactly a flat surface. And while it is not an anti-aliasing technique per se, but in practice, this turns this scene, for example, where there's a lot of errors due to this defighting, to something as stable as this. So this is what the cells actually look like, and where we could see those oscillations. And we still benefit from our clustering from before, and we're able to store view-dependent data. The last aspect is, how could we compute this view-dependent data so that it will be generated as efficiently as possible and that it would converge as fast as possible? Here, we are considering really direct lighting from environment maps, where a sphere around the scene is lighting all the objects. What is used usually is an important sampling function. And this function will drive most of the samples towards the part of the environment map that contribute the most. So for example, here, we will shoot a lot of rays towards the sun and very few rays towards darker areas. And this works well in many scenes that achieves very fast convergence, really great results. The problem is when we are in an interior scene, then we'll still keep on shooting all those rays towards the sun, even if they are always occluded by the ceiling. So it's not a very efficient use of our ray budget. What we would like is a sampling like this, where we would focus on the areas that are really useful, and we can trace our rays where we want. So there's a whole field of computer graphics interested in that, in ray guiding, to be able to generate some probability distribution functions to achieve this kind of sampling, depending on all the points in the scene and so on. Those techniques, though, tend to be quite complex, and the results really depend on the kind of scene we want to use. Here, we decided to go on an approach that's very, very simple. So we cut the environment map in two pieces. One is the environment map itself, so with its iridescence values and importance per pixel, and the other one is a mask. And we start our process using the classical importance sampling. So we shoot rays towards the sun here, they get blocked. And we shoot also the occasional ray towards the windows. And when we hit those windows, we update this mask on the right. So that in the next frame, we will be able to use this mask and to shoot rays mostly towards the windows. So this is an approach that's centralized. We have only one of those masks. So it does not take into account, for example, like one little window that will have a specific visibility and another window that has another visibility. This is really global to all the points that are visible in the current image. And since we are seeing also many points like this, the rays originate from various points, and the mask tends to be larger than if we just use it in a single point. But in general, that really improves a lot the resolution of this kind of visibility problem. The computation of the important sampling function is usually done as a preprocess or when we load the environment map. Here we need to update it permanently or at least every few frames. So for this, we use the cutpoint sampling method that relends itself really well to GPU implementation. So this technique starts with an importance value per pixel of the environment map. And from this, it computes a CDF. So this cumulative distribution function is just computed by a prefix sum on the GPU. Once we have this CDF, we can compute a uniform partition of it and invert it by finding, using binary search, all the edges of those partitions in pixel space. Then that gives us a partition of the pixels of the environment map, where each partition has an equal probability. When we want to sample this environment map, we can then perform a uniform sampling of the partitions, and then use a binary search to find the pixel that we want to sample in the environment map. And this is the kind of image that we can obtain using classical importance sampling. So here the lighting is quite complicated, highly occluded, and we can see it really takes time to converge. While when we switch to our approach, the convergence is pretty much immediate, because we are putting together the knowledge of all the rays that we are tracing in the image to compute our mask. So if we put it all together, we start from a G-buffer, here with geometric and material information, and from there we operate in world space. We compute the hash cell corresponding to each pixel, using also our clustering for fast memory accesses, and for each pixel, we are going to trace a number of rays depending on our visibility. And this updates the hash map with irradiance values and outgoing radiance value for each hash cell that is visible. Then we can go to screen space and generate the actual image from the content of the hash map. Since this image can have discretization artifacts, we can filter it in screen space and finally generate our final image. And this is the kind of result we can obtain. So this has been generated on RTX 3090. And this scene contains 300 million polygons. And what we can see is that the details are really preserved, especially all the high frequencies in the shadows and the reflections are there. And here all materials are glossy. You can see here all the high frequencies. This other scene is also interesting in the sense that we can see how the shadows of the pillars, for example, are preserved and not smoothed out. We can also see that sometimes the technique takes a few frames to converge. This is due to the trade-off. Also, we chose to have very high reactivity, no ghosting, and no excessive filtering of the scene features. So that's a bit more visible, especially when we go inside, but thanks to our sampling technique, then the convergence still remains very fast. And we can also see that we do not have any ghosting. I would like to thank you for your attention, and I take the opportunity also to thank my colleagues at NVIDIA that really helped me with this work. And I will be happy to get your feedback. Thank you. See you soon.